Okay, thank you everyone for coming. This is very, very delighted to open this year's seminar series. Especially we are talking very close to my heart, the connection between neuroscience and artificial intelligence. And today we have with us Hava Siegelmann. Hava is a senior faculty for bio-inspired AI from the University of Massachusetts, the Department of Computer Science, and the program for neuroscience and the MBA. Hava made many contributions to the field, and the research is mainly on lifelong learning, which I think we're going to hear about today, in artificial neural system. She was a program manager for DARPA's program on lifelong learning in machines, where she was awarded the meritorious Public Service Medal for her research and leadership at DARPA. She has many, many other awards, and among them the Obama Presidential Brain Initiative Award and the Ronald Head Award. Today we hear about lifelong learning. So lifelong learning is basically what help you to come to this talk, get new information, and put it inside your knowledge base. But until recently, machines couldn't do it at all. And now they're getting better and better at it. Thanks to the contribution of Hava. Very excited to hear what she has to ask.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for having me here. It's really a great pleasure for me to visit. I did my master's at the Hebrew University in the computer science. Okay, so I'll be talking today about lifelong learning, which is inspired by brain. So in general, when we look at AI, the situation is really funny and people take sides. Is it very good? Is it like beyond human capability? Like we can have in some of images, or is it not as trustworthy as we want? Can we actually trust people outside in the field? And this is kind of a large discrepancy, it's a little bit surprising, and I think one of the reasons that is behind it is that the AI, the way it's built, almost until today, or at least until very few years ago, we pretty much talking about two kinds of AI. One is this program, we write, if you see a light, you take right, something like that. And the other one is a trained, kind of like a neural network. You have a very large data set, and you train the neural networks, and it fits its own weights, and now the neural network acts as the computer. So in either way, both ways are different, because in the first one, we have to understand what you write. In the second one, we have to give a large database. But either way that we go, after we're done training it or teaching it, the machine is frozen. So now we take the machine outside and we expect it to work. So in general, if you think about neural networks, the network improves greatly its performance as long as it's training, but then we stop training, we finish with the training set and we take it outside, and it cannot become better with experience. So all this terminology that neural networks become better with experience, I don't know where it came from, but as it experiences, it cannot change it, it's frozen. But it does fail if there are things that are too far away from what it saw. So it can do the tiny generalization between inputs that it saw, so it doesn't have exactly the same input, but if you get a little bit farther, you get something that you don't want. So you really want to have the type of AI that is open, that can actually improve with time, and it sees more things, and that it actually also look at itself and sees, well, something is not working the way that I predicted it to work. Something is wrong, let me work it out. And the kind of the main reason that we want to go to the lifelong learning type is first is because there is no way to come with any possible future when you have your training. So I think the AI that is kind of winning in this are the self-driving cars, and they work on about million and million of examples and hours of many hours of work, and we still don't see it on the streets. It's very hard to think of how to do that. There is then malfunction in unseen circumstances, and there is another reason that, you know, when you have AI, you always think about safety and security, because, you know, if you have a fleet of cars, you don't want something from outside to kind of trick all of them together. And if we have something that is changing but is not exactly the same, even if it's the same knowledge, but is represented in different ways, it's much harder to trick our system. So for all these reasons, DARPA was interested to have a program that would be looking at something like that. And really to look at AI system that can learn during its runtime. And you know, since if you look, there's no technology methodology that is giving that, really the only way to look for systems that continue learning without catastrophically forgetting everything from before is biology. And in particular, neuroscience was one of the large focus. So I was lucky for DARPA to accept this idea for programming and support it very widely. So we have really two groups. We have the groups of mathematicians and computer science that work in the system. We have a group of biologists and a bunch of neuroscientists that were supposed to find a system that they know best and find mechanism in that, that have features of learning and explain to us what kind of learning, so that we have in our mind all kind of different learning except for the input outputs that we know to do in AI. And there is a bunch of solutions that came, and I'm going just to talk a little bit about two of them, and then I'm going to move forward because the program just finished a few months ago, and kind of ready for the next thing. I mean, both DARPA soon and us, all of us in the research world. So just kind of to go to what we want to do with the lifelong learning. So there is a field, subfield that is called continual learning. And it started, I think, in 2016. And continual learning, the idea is that you don't learn everything that you want together at the same time. But first of all, let's say you learn to separate between 0 and 1, and then later you learn to separate between 2s and 3s, and you want your system to do both tasks, both to separate 0 and 1 and to separate 2s and 3s. So this is called continual learning. So it's all happened in a training time, but the training set is not kind of shuffled in a way that everything is coming together, but it's coming kind of like one after the other. And there is a bunch of programs that came between 2016 and today that try to see how they can remember the previous one when they go to the next one. And the reason is catastrophic forgetting. So since AI, the neural network thing, is looking at very, very simplistic neurons, you know, our neurons are summation, multiplication, and one linearity at the top, and all the memory is just in the synapses. So with this kind of network, if all the memory of the synapses is helping us to separate between 0 and 1, and now we take the same network and we train it to separate 2s and 3s, then a lot of hands that were there so that to separate between 0 and 1 are gone. So now we can do very well the second one, but you might have totally lost the first one, which is what is called catastrophic forgetting in the field of AI. So a bunch of companies, Google DeepMind and Stanford University and another Google, came with these ideas that if you train for five things, so for 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that's why the five came here. And if you don't do any of their tricks, you start forgetting things, and if you do the trick, you can learn the next one and still remember the previous one. So you still get the test accuracy of everything perfectly. And people seem to be a little bit happy with that. But there was a reality which was very funny. So when you train it with this continual learning, you could separate between 0 and 1. But if I ask you now to separate between 0 and 5, you couldn't do that because there was no task that was doing it. You were never taught to do that. Actually, the situation was worse, because if you were teaching a neural network without these tricks, you could do a little bit of that. So the issue is that all these tricks or algorithm, what they do is they separate very strongly between one task to the other. So this is, you know, this area can do 0, 1 when I'm not touching it. Now I will change the rest of it to 3, and whatever works is very important for 2, 3, I don't touch it. That's how they manage to remember some kind of regularization. But then they really separated the task, and there was no way to put them together. So you got, you know, you got some kind of AI that can learn continually, but it really cannot do lifelong. It really cannot put things together. And the basic of lifelong learning is you really want to have the ability to learn in the world. So continually is perhaps part of what you do in the world, but I think the main part of what you do is that you want to take things from first grade, let's say how to hold a pen, together with something that you learn in 12th grade about some history of I don't know, and something that you saw today and put it all together for understanding of political situation or something. So like putting things together from different times of your life and knowing which model, which piece to take and putting them together. That's really the basis of lifelong learning. That's, I think, a way that you want to think about what we do over lifetime in terms of learning. And we take into account that there may be some kind of forgetting if you reach the possible number of all memories in the world, but it's not something that we get here. I mean, all the catastrophic forgetting that we talk in AI, there is a lot of room. It's just that they are arriving in the same places and not separating them or don't know how to put them together. So a few ideas came, and as I said, I'm going to show only two of them, which are my favorite, perhaps because they are with time. I mean, there is not a lot of time because they both were published recently, I mean, in the last few years, but they're improving every day, and they seem to be perhaps one way of going forward. So one of them is the idea of brain replay. So you guys know what brain replay, I'm not going to tell you that, but from the AI point of view, the first idea that came for when people wanted to think about continued learning and later about lifelong learning, is that what you do is you'll keep your data, and then you'll teach the network 0-1. And then you'll keep all the data. So now when you teach 2-3, you will not teach 2-3, you'll teach 2-3 and 0-1. So every time you'll keep your previous data, and as you come with a new thing, then you'll bring the new one and the old one, and you train, and network not to be trained on a few classes at the same time, and we do. There are lots of problems here with that. First of all, I think in brain we don't have this capability to remember exactly what was outside. We have something inside that we can bring it up, and it's really useful, and it's very problematic in terms of growing and scaling. So the second idea that is very nice, and I like it a lot, is the idea that we learn a generative model. So in addition to separate the 0-1, we also will have a generative model that will give us some of the zeros and some of the one. It doesn't have to be exactly the same one that were given us the input, but it has to have something of the same type. And then when we learn the new one, we'll be able to bring some of the old one. So this sounds very good, but there is a practicality, and the practicality for people from computer science here that work with generative networks. We know that all this beautiful picture of people that were created and they look perfect is a small percentage of what the network usually gives. So you usually get a lot of garbage from the generative. And in the paper, you put the nice one. But here, you don't want to have a person looking at the images and deciding if they are good. It has to become something automatic, and we can't really fully trust that. So the next idea was to do something that we call brain-like, brain-like replay. And the idea was, and this is work with Andreas Torias and Guido van der Ve, and the idea was that you don't generate separately, and you don't generate all the way to the input, but you generate just to some level. And this is actually very easy to do. And here, if it's at some level, you don't have to go all the way out. It doesn't have to be exactly similar to the input that you had, because it creates more and more, it gets more and more error as you continue generating. So we stop high when you didn't generate a lot of errors. And what we get is, if you want to think about it, it's kind of an abstraction of something that we had. So we don't learn the 0-1 the way that they look outside, but we learn the 0-1 the way that they look after some layers that they already know. So it's kind of an abstraction of that. It's not easier to learn. It looks horrible. So if you look, it looks like this type of digits, and people do not like it. But it gives you some capabilities that you didn't have before, and this is the capability that you can start putting things together that came from different tests. It has some kind of memory that is more natural. And people continue working now on replay in a very interesting way. So one way that you can think about lifelong learning is that something you have to learn immediately now, because you're driving now and there is more sun now, and you have to tune yourself to more sun in your eyes and to more glare that comes from other cars. So there is something that must be now, but there is also the offline, and also in many of the on the pervasive apps, like your mobile phone or your Google glasses, you have off time, and in this off time, you have more time than you can replay. And it's very, very much lifelong in the sense that you look around and you collect information, and you see your cat and the chair, and it's not like all coming together. So it's kind of coming in a way that it's natural. Some other work, you know, this is actually from 22, recent work, that people say, how can I minimally replay? What's the minimal number or the minimal thing that I need in order to lead to this kind of robustness? And this is one idea of that when you that you want to replay things that were in the brain but were in similar representations, because these are the ones that can get confused. The ones that are far away, you perhaps don't need to touch because there are no confusion. So this is an ongoing research. People still working on that level. So this is one direction that people were going. Another direction that was also very, very successful is the self-directed learning. So these are examples from vision. The notion of self-directed learning is that perhaps you don't have enough input-output, maybe not at all. So you can create questions to yourself. You can get an image and start asking yourself questions. Take a piece out and ask yourself, what was it? And you know the answer, so you can try to see if your algorithm to guess it makes sense. Or you can take a picture, take the colors, and then try all kind of different colors and see, does this make sense? So you kind of learn to connect particular images with particular colors. This is a reference image, and the idea here, you take a scene, and you take pieces from the same scene, and ask if this came from the same scene. In this example, you have in the same scene a train and a train station. So it's not just about similarity, you know, both having the same tire, but something that actually happened. So you try understanding kind of association, you start getting association with this, which is very interesting. So you can do the same thing with videos. You can say, what's right order, what's wrong order? So you start getting some understanding of how things move with time. And as you do that, it allows you to do all kind of really nice things that are very practical, which is to do things like smart searches. So if you have some association and you have to look through the catalog, you know, your entrance to the house and you see that there is a refrigerator, you go to there, you go to the stove, you go to the cable. So just based on what kind of association you saw before. So you don't have to start really looking all over the house of where the kettle can be. You already saw it not too far from, and that's where you're going. So these kind of things are very helpful. And very recently, Facebook or Meta just kind of take it forward, and this is going to be like the next focus research for them. Just to say, you know, during the type of lifelong learning, it was very hard for me because all the time our researchers were taken, and OpenAI was the worst. They just were taking people over every time we had to, you know, to take new ones. It was hard. But the whole notion of lifelong learning, if you want to think, if you want to test it, the notion is you don't test it against something that is not moving, because it's not there to do better ImageNet or C4pen or whatever. It's there to deal with situation that things are changing. You know, you alter the unit capacity, or you move the goals, or something is changing. So, like here, the friend changed to four. So, kind of try to think of things that you didn't think in advance, and somebody in the back start making changes. So, this is the type of robustness that you're looking for. So, this is ended. Two months ago, the program ended. I left it already 2 months ago because you usually spend 4 years in DARPA and then you give your program to the next person. And then you can be a consultant for free if you want. So then the question is how to take it forward and what are the next important things that were not treated there and that are really important for us for AI. And since I'm here, let me bring it already as the question of what else can we learn from neuroscience. And I think that there are a few, and I will talk about a few of them just. So one is the notion of abstraction. So in AI, we always talk about generalization. It's so basic because we teach it what we know at the moment. We teach it what the inputs are. We want the AI just like us. We want it to drive the current situation. 100% of the people. So the whole notion of generation is the heart of AI. It's not intelligent if it cannot generalize. So first I want to talk about a little bit about brain abstraction and brain generalization and what you can take. Then I want to talk about this issue of safety. So when you take a machine and you want it to work in all kinds of situations, how can you protect it? Because you don't know what will happen in this situation. Can you protect it without going to the details in advance? And then the third one, which kind of comes from the second, is can you develop temporal understanding? And by temporal understanding, I mean if there is day and night, if there is other kind of circles or periodic, you don't want to have to learn very, very long if you can find tricks of repetition. It's the same that we do in pattern recognition of vision. We want to do a pattern recognition of time, of temporal features. I'll talk a little bit about ever-learning and ever-learning in particular about how we can let backpropagation go and think about other training algorithms which are much better for lifelong learning. And actually, we'd love to hear from you guys if you find any relation, perhaps to brain, because the people that are working on that are computer scientists. So it can be very interesting to see. And here I have something that I'm in particularly interested in this group, which is why I particularly wanted to visit you guys. We're looking at structural efficiency, and we want to be able to adapt circuits both fast and also slow, and we want to have kind of richness of neuron, richness of connectivity, different ways to have memories, different ways to connect, to think about memories in all kinds of other ways, except for synapses, perhaps about chains, about other levels of abstraction. So this is something that I'll talk a little bit at the end, but I have more questions than answers. Okay, so I want to talk first about abstraction. And this is actually an old work. It's already 2015, but it really comes handy when I want to think about AI that is lifelong learning. So we all know about the visual hierarchies, you know, in vision, and perhaps there's also auditory and some other sensory, and you know much more about it than me. And the question is there also a way to look at it in general, in the brain, so that we have connectome hierarchy that would be something about going on abstraction, perhaps with concept, perhaps we'll have a better way to understand how we talk about fairness and all kind of issues that is not something that we get from the sensory data directly, but really kind of bring it up a little. So an idea that a postdoc in my lab had is that even that the brain is very, very recursive, we can think about it in some way like a deep neural network, in the way that we say, you know, we put some input in the entrance, how long does it take until it propagates to somewhere in the brain? So you can think about it as a kind of a combination of a resting state fMRI and ETI, perhaps. And then it would be right to do for every sensory cortex separately. So from the visual, we can start here and, you know, go farther and farther in. So I color it from dark to less dark. And then we can kind of color brains from dark to less dark for different inputs and summarize them. And then we can come to the question, which is the following. There is 25 years or more of a fMRI collected for different activity. Is there a connection between the abstraction of the connectivity, of the activity that we want, and the which places, how deep in the brain that main activity is? And this was the question, and we were really hoping that the answer is yes, but the answer was no. So we realized that there is actually something else. Very similar, but not exactly. So when we take this fMRI and we ask at which beam deeper in the brain we can see activity, we actually see activities all over. Okay, so we cannot really say that we see one location, but we can do another thing. What we can do, for example, for one activity here, which is finger tapping, we can look and say, you know, all this that we call them the beam one, which is the closest to the input, there is total activity which sum with this. And little polynomial combining each other, but you can do a very, very rough approximation with line, which will really just give you the direction. So then you say that, you know, in general, with finger tapping, there is more activity in the entrance to the brain, while when you think about reasoning and look at all the fMRI and average them this way, there is more activity on all people and more labs that did it deeper in the brain. And you see, you know, you have things all over the brain, so it's not clean as the way that it is, but it actually gives you slopes. So taking, you know, all data that, that one can find in the in this area, you can give to different activity different slopes, which can be negative slope, positive slope. And if you want, you can take the different activities that are kept in a variety of data sets. And to each of them, you know, you have this real picture of where the activity was in a different bin, and then we can do our very rapid approximation of line, and we organize all of them from the most negative line to the most positive line, and that's what you get. You get something like that. And I particularly like naming, because if you guys remember your Bible classes in elementary school, if you remember what Adam was told to do, his job was to name the animals. So I thought that's very cute, you know, he's really a smart, abstracting being. And just last year in 21, a very interesting work was published with the students from Johns Hopkins, and they say they take the same idea, and what they do is they take different deep networks, and it's very hard to know in deep networks whether they will generalize well on data set. And what they do is they look for the same feature. And they say, you know, the feature that we actually say is that there is correlation between activation inside to more abstract, to harder, and activation close to the input to simpler input. So if you put it with number, it will say that for a number like one, which is kind of simple, it makes sense to have more, it will be, like if it was the same, it would have more activity here, and if it's more complex, it will have more activity deeper. And they actually came with the, I mean, I was part of that, but it's a nice group, and they actually came with this idea that if you have a network and you have your data, if you get this very high correlation of deep and deeper activity for inputs that are more complex, it seems to generalize very, very well. And this is now the state of the art. It's, it was published in 21, but it's still the state of the art. It's very, very strong predictor, kind of jump about the mathematical predictors that existed before. So it's nice to see that sometimes something is coming from there.
Yeah. So how do you distinguish between more complex and just more intense or on pixels?
Yeah, so you mean how do you decide something is more complex?
Yeah, A here also has much more pixels, intensity of...
Oh, so the way we think about it, as simple computer scientists, we have the same number of pixels, because it's all the same.
So you normalize, not like...
Yeah, everything is normalized. Also in the brain, this one, is everything is normalized to the number of experiments that we have. Everything is normalized, otherwise you cannot talk. So this is normalized. So there are two things to do here. If you go tiny bit more with this, you need to have some information theory to decide what input is more complex, unrelated to the neural network. And then you look at the neural networks and you compare the activity to different layers. And then you correlate that. And if the correlation is very high, you suspect the generalization is more parallel.
So the complexity has to do with the task, or is it just something about the...
So everything that was done, this is an excellent question. So and I really want to answer you because it's something that we need to do. So everything that was done here was about images. So the complexity of images, you do information theory, and it gives you the complexity. But the right thing to do is to try to do it on computer games, on actually activity. We started to bring it on computer games. It didn't work as well, and the student was taken to open. Yeah. I have a very bad track with that. I think that the most interesting program, and actually if somebody here wants to collaborate, and they're going to be extremely open for that, I would love to do it actually on activities, because the fMRI was all about activities. We translate it to images, and because it's not abstraction, we made it into complexity. So whatever was high abstraction, we say, well, abstraction is when you put many things together higher, so complex is when you put many parts together, it can't end. So this is the reference, and it works very well, but I think it really has to be done on activities. So if you can take it on activities, like human activities, and then the computer to do activities, and to see if it happens with the same way that the environment works. So this is something that is totally has to be done. Okay, I want to talk now about safety. So, you know, the issue is this, if you have an environment, and the environment changes a lot, then if it changes very slow, then you can have your time step, which are slow. And you have all these fantastic papers that show that animals, based on their mass, they move differently. Like hippopotamus move differently in water and outside the water. It's like really nice, like what does this ballerina jumps, and look at this hippopotamus. Like that, it's beautiful. But in general, if you're afraid that something will happen, then you want to have very small steps. You want to do a lot of things. But it's a huge waste. So I think that the body has this solution that you can have some regular time step that fits the environment, perhaps from an evolutionary point of view, something that makes sense, but you still have these reflexes that keeps you from the known unknowns, that you don't know exactly what comes, but something can come and you want to close. You want to be ready with that. So one way that we've started working on that is simulation of an inverted pendulum, and we wanted to make this very hard. So we started putting wings in the inverted pendulum from a different direction. There was wind, and we were playing with that in very crazy program that we really ourselves couldn't know what kind of wind and direction is coming. But the idea first was just let's try it if it works. And if you try it, if it works, it means to add, and this is handmade, okay? We check and saw that it's better for this, that when the angle is this, we better start moving it. So this is still handmade. Just to see if there is at all points to start talking about reflexes. So we can see that with reflexes, we can survive much longer. And it still doesn't take a lot of steps because we make it up, if you can say, just in a particular situation. But from the AI point of view, we'd like to have something that is not handmade. We don't want for every situation, you know, to bring the programmer to say what's the angle, because it was a lot of trial and error, and this is the... So there is this paper, it's very interesting, it's paper, Terry Sijnowski is one of them, and is one of the authors. And they showed, you guys probably know more about it. It was very interesting to me. So when you move your eyes from side to side, I didn't realize until I read it that you really do it very slowly. And actually the moving of the head is added to that and actually helps us to get it fast. And it was kind of funny to me because I don't know, always I had in my mind that moving of the whole body is slow, and I thought of the eyes, you know, I was thinking maybe about you know, the fast eye movement, but it's really a more like a combination. So if you want to think about fast and slow, we can think about the fast and slow system, we can think about it in many ways. And here in this work, we started working in many ways. So you can have that there is scaling of the slow to the fast. This would be just like beforehand, that if we don't need the fast kick, we don't let it come, and we don't need the reflexes, we don't let them go, or we can combine them to help things. And it's kind of an interesting idea, because we have a layer of fast controller and slow controller. What is surprising is that there is a way to learn it fast. So from the AI point of view, you don't have to learn all the slow and all the fast. We kind of put it in a way together that it doesn't increase much the learning time. It's actually very, very good for training too. So this is like an interesting idea. And you know, it's still a kind of new, just literally submitted it last year, just before I went on the plane, I remember the idea is that here in this picture, here in this image, the blue, so we have here the response times. So these are possible responses, and the blue, this is possible times of possible changes. The blue is if you have the slow response to the machine, and the orange is if you have this fast. So in general, if you have fast response, you have better accuracy, but horrible energy. So you really want this sweet spot of both them, and that's kind of this effort of putting this together, where what you want to have is you want to measure the return per action. So you want to have few actions and high return. Okay, the return is kind of like in reinforcement learning, is the grade that you did, you get on what you did, how well you did, and you don't want to have many actions. You can do many actions, but it's a horrible waste. So how to keep the number of actions similar, but not going much previously. Okay, so this is just the beginning of work of reflex. There's a lot to do there, as I told you, just submitted the first thing. And another student, I think this one of the smartest students I've ever had, is working on temporal understanding of the environment. And the idea is here that, you know, the environment has these periodic changes, but our neural network, the way we work on it currently in AI, once we finish learning it, it doesn't change. So lifelong learning, it changes, but it changes slowly. It doesn't like changes in a way that defines periods. And the idea was, you know, let's understand the environment temporally and allow the network to update its connectivity with the same period. So we don't have to relearn everything again, everything, you know. If I learn how this hopper is doing one activity, I don't want to restart for every activity again. And so the goal here, given that it was paid by DARPA, the goal was here to get high prediction accuracy, even if we have very dirty input. And you know, more companies and us also want to assume that we have dirty input, irregular and missing data. It's very realistic. We want to have fast learning, fast reaction. And there is something very interesting in neural network, and I want to tell it to you, because this is something that always gives me a headache. So neural network, if you want to train it on something, you have usually to take a very large neural network with many, many parameters you need to train. Then you can prune it, and then you get a small neural network that does almost as good as the large one. But if you take a small neural network, kind of at the same size, and try to learn a task on it, it doesn't work. This is like something that we're, you know, kind of hitting our head. And so we always learn a very, very large network. And you always do something so that in runtime, it will be pruned. However, when we prune, it doesn't generalize sometimes very well. There are lots of issues there. So one thing that we really wanted to get is to be able to train smaller network immediately. And something here in allowing the periodical changes to be is very interesting that it gives it. So the solution here was what I said, temporary changing weights. And if you look here, you see like one neuron with the weights around it coming back. And this is an opening. Okay, so it's the same neuron kind of opening it. And the idea is that every time you have different weight. So in the top, it will be all the time the same style. This is like the regular neural network. In the bottom, if you open it with time, every time it will have different weight. And that's kind of the idea that we learn, instead of learning scalar values, we'll be learning temporal functions. And much stronger, and somehow it's a very good place to hide temporal function. And I'll show you why we get something like that. So these are static weights, and if we want, so what we did here in the bedroom, you see these green dots. So what we did, we just kind of created this periodical and dirty input, and then made lots of inputs to be lost. Okay, it's the same exact data here and here, and we said we want to learn it, but we gave very little time. We gave only 50 epochs to do that, and that's the type of things that you manage to do when you have fixed weights, and this is the type of behavior that you manage to do when you have temporal weights. This is within the first 50 operations. And the second line is just to show keeping a small network, but changing the weight, it's not actually cheating. And because we're going to count the number of times that we change and put it as parameters too, but still somehow it comes from a very different direction and increase the state space hugely in a very interesting way. So
in changing weights, you mean that the neuron itself is a dynamical system that learns internals?
So the neurons are still dumb, and the next step that I want to do with you guys is smarter neurons. So the neurons are still the same, really dumb, but what we do is the network, kind of like, is we learn